If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode of Mind Pump.
Wow. I'm going to hijack him.
For the first 27 minutes, him. Adam, Justin, and I have our intro conversation.
Find out
the best part of the show.
Newest superfood is.
Yeah, it might have to do with cockroaches.
that was a long pause there.
Then we talk about repurposing failed drugs. Find out why Viagra is good for blood pressure.
Yeah. That was the intent, right?
We also talk about the show Planet Earth. Adam actually has a hack for watching Planet Earth. It involves cannabis. Then we talk about Jordan Peterson. Listen, go to YouTube, watch this guy's lectures. Blow your mind. Literally.
Sal's working on getting him on the show.
I hope we can get him on the show. It'd be so awesome. We also talk about the Organifi Cacao Bliss and how we make some desserts with it. They are our sponsor. If you go to OrganifiShop.com and enter the code MINDPUMP without a space, you'll get a massive discount. We also mentioned bone broth from Thrive Market. Of course, Thrive Market has lots of stuff available on their site, all non-GMO, most of it organic. We are also sponsored by them. If you go to ThriveMarket.com/MINDPUMP, here's what you're going to get. 1 month free membership, $20 off your first three orders of $49 or more, and free shipping. Then we get into the questions.
What's not organic and Thrive? Just like the stuff, like silverware like and soap. Like the soap.
Maybe. Well, that Pirate's Booty wasn't organic. It's just non-GMO.
Oh,
mm-hmm. I see. That's
there you
why
go.
I did that.
Good looking out.
Then we get into the questions.
I've been saying organic. That's why I'm glad you cleared that
good.
Up.
Good. Okay. First question was: how did we work out while we were fasting? You know, without food for 48 to 72 hours. What kind of lifting and training did we do, or
mental reps?
Were we smart and we did other things,
or did Justin do a CrossFit wad?
So, yeah. The next question was
Cindy. Find out if that's true.
We talk
Jennifer
about our orthorexic behavior. Someone wants to know if we've ever experienced orthorexic behaviors, and what are some good ways to overcome them when we start to see that we're starting to have them. The next question was: someone wants us to talk about appetite pills, like, do they work? Is it a good idea to take something to suppress your appetite, or is it a bad thing? That answer is pretty easy. Finally, if we had to hire another Mind Pump host, who would it be and why?
Find out who's the only one of us that's irreplaceable.
Irreplaceable.
One guess.
It's definitely Justin.
Whoa. Hey, come on.
Sorry.
He's like that spoiler alert guy.
Gave it away.
Awful. Hey, we're cutting you off the intros.
They're done listening now.
Also.
Yeah. Gave them everything.
Right. You get to free. Don't worry about listening.
Stay tuned. Yeah. like, wait for it. Yeah. Oh, I just gave it to you.
Gave it to him.
Yeah.
Also, it's January. We're still in January. We're still doing, you know what's funny?
Still not too late to get started. Fuck.
This is, every time we do this, anytime we give away our limited edition t-shirts, which some people now are selling on eBay for over $10,000.
Wow.
That's not true. It started a whole new economy.
Not true. But every time we give away free t-shirts, people go nuts.
We are accepting cryptocurrency this month.
Yeah.
So you'll get a free Mind Pump t-shirt if you enroll in any of our discounted bundles, and they are discounted deep. Now, our bundles include multiple MAPS programs put together for a particular goal, the most popular of which is the MAPS Super Bundle, which includes all of our core MAPS programs. It's 1 year of exercise programming. In other words, you could buy and enroll in the MAPS Super Bundle. You could start today, and you'll follow all the MAPS programs, all the workouts. You'll have your exercises, your reps, your sets. You'll have video demos. You'll have exercise blueprints, everything. Follow each one as you go through the different phases, as you go through the different MAPS. And at the end of all of that, you will have done 12 months. 12 months of expert exercise programming. Phenomenal results. If you enroll in that bundle and any of our other bundles, you'll get a free t-shirt. If you have more questions, or if you just want to enroll because you're smart, just go to mindpumpmedia.com. All right, Doug, let's give away some shirts. How many reviews did we get this time?
We got 22 reviews.
Whoa, that's a lot. That's actually a little more than our average.
Yeah, no, we did pretty well this last week.
Excellent.
And we're going to give out six shirts.
Six shirts.
So the first one up is Keely Bergeron 94, PSU Navy 2019, TC Dill, N Howard95, KK Denny, Casey Kaser, all of you are winners. Send the name I just read to iTunes@mindpumpmedia.com. Send your shirt size, your shipping address, and we'll get that right out to you.
And if you want a chance to win a t-shirt, all you got to do is go to your podcast app, leave a review. It's got to be a 5-star review because I ain't giving a free t-shirt to somebody who doesn't think we're the best. And if we like your review, we think it's one of the better ones, if it's true or funny or awesome, we'll pick you and you'll get a free t-shirt.
Oh, here we go now.
Come on, Adam.
Here we go now.
That's like, yeah.
You remember what that was? You're like giving it away.
Yeah. Give it away. You know what was, what did we listen to this morning while we're working out?
It's hard to wrap off the,
oh.
Here we go now. Right? You gotta have like
Enya?
A little roll in
some Enya?
No, we didn't listen to Enya this morning.
Don't fucking lie. We know.
There was no Enya.
We know Jessica's got
was
the playlist
it deadlifting day?
No. No, it was not Enya. So, you're.
Sail away.
You know how there's old songs that you used to lift to that you, I don't know if this happens to you, this happens to me sometimes. I forget about them. I stop listening to them
and
for years.
Come across it.
Bro, Beastie Boys, Sabotage. Great song to lift to. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
What a great song to lift to.
Yeah.
Damn. It was good.
Did it just come through the playlist today or something? Well,
I put on Rage Against the Machine playlist, and that song was in the
playlist. That's what I think the real brilliance behind like Pandora and where Spotify are at now. Like, I think that's so cool to how it learns your patterns of what you like, and then you get these little, it's like having a little treat or a nugget one day, you know, because we've listened to, so you figure how much music you've listened to over the course of your, you know, 30 plus years of your life. Like, there's a lot of great songs I forgot about, and then every once in a while you'll be listening to one of those lists. It's like, oh,
you forget.
God, I like this.
Oh, yeah. You forget. It happened again the other day with Cypress Hill.
Yeah.
Insane in the Membrane. I was like, oh shit, that's right.
Somebody DM'd me, one of our fans, and he like reminded me of like so many good songs. Like one of them was like a Tower of Snakes, and oh my god, the breakdown. Any song that has like an amazing breakdown, like I get this like surge of testosterone like immediately.
God damn.
I gotta throw something.
I felt that right now.
Yeah.
I just posted a video in the forum and I just tagged. Did you see it yet?
No.
It's this guy jamming on some drums, but instead of drumsticks, he's using dildos.
Wow.
Yeah, so it's...
Does it actually sound good, too?
It's all thud.
Hey, dude,
thud,
listen,
thud.
It puts a whole new spin on the whole, you know, rock out with your cock out.
Hey, man.
He's got two of them
but
there.
But that guy has plans and after the show. You know what I'm saying?
And he's jamming on them. So I just read this interesting article on a site on or a page on Facebook. Can't remember the name of it. But so sorry, can't give you any love there. Mm. But so scientist, ready for this? I'm going to read the headline to you, and then we're just going to get your responses.
Okay.
Superfood, a new superfood has been discovered.
A new one? Is it a?
Oh my god! Is it goji?
I think it's
acai.
A berry that only grows somewhere in certain temperature.
If you guess,
it can't be a berry again.
If you guess what this is, I would have been blown away. There's no way you'll guess. So the new superfood.
Algae.
Scientists think cockroach milk could be the next super protein
milk
source.
They produce milk?
They
their
apparently,
little titties?
They do.
The little cockroach titties?
So apparently the
That's so gross.
Apparently the milk that comes out of a cockroach is chock full of protein. Maybe you could use it, harvest it, transform it into a food supplement. It's the Pacific beetle cockroach. Now the milk that they produce is three times more nutrient dense and protein dense than buffalo milk, which is already more dense than cow milk. So if you compare it to cow milk, cockroaches.
I want to see an assembly line.
Hammer.
You know, of all these cockroaches.
We're going
down
that route. You know what I think is happening? I think what's going on right now is they're trying to warm us up because I think scientists all got together at some point and they're like, all right, guys, everybody listen.
We're running out of the magical. Yeah.
By the year 2025, we all have to eat bugs.
Yeah.
So let's start getting people, like they're doing a launch sequence. You know what I'm saying? They got to drip it a little bit.
But cockroach, you know, that's like a bold move. Like, why not?
You guys love them cricket chips, man. I can't get down with that yet.
Cockroaches are dirty.
Well, think about it this way. You have there's no animal right activist that's going to defend, like, going to be,
that's true.
Like, nobody likes cockroaches.
Yeah.
I think people will celebrate that we're, you know, killing them that
way. Oh, no, that'd be awesome. Think about the pest control businesses now. They can double as a also milk business.
Yeah, yeah.
So you've got your cockroach business.
Eradicate them and milk them from
right
here.
But you're not
right
even
here.
Killing them. You're just capturing them. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah. Just start making money on the boat. On both. See? There it is. God, that's gross.
That is really gross.
I don't want to drink anything that comes from anything.
That is not real.
That's an awful image. If that was on
the fuck do you get the milk?
Hey, if that was on the front of the logo, if that was on the label, who buys that?
And are you sure it's milk? You know what I mean? Like we're on the body.
How do we milk a cockroach?
I don't think you. I don't know.
You
just squeeze the hell out of it.
So do
it's impossible. Our hands are far too large.
Yeah,
their teeth are too small.
Yeah.
I don't know how it works.
How do you? Well, I guess we could extract it after you kill. You probably crush it, kill it, and then you'd have to do some sort of a filtering process.
No,
right?
I think that would be but I would think that would be inefficient. I think the smart thing to do would be to figure out how to harvest the superfood milk without killing the cockroach, because then you can. You know?
Oh, so like how we do with cows. So there's gonna be like machines.
Yeah.
It's like super tiny little machines. You know what? Have you seen the movie that's coming out? Arms. I kind of want to see it.
Which one?
It reminds me of like Honey, I Shrunk the Kids when we were little. That movie. You guys remember that movie, right?
Oh, yeah. The one where they shrink people down.
Yeah. Have you seen that? Have you seen the new one that's coming out?
Just that the title says it all.
It's called Downsizing.
Yeah.
It's called Downsizing.
That was obvious.
Oh, it's kind of cool because the theory, and I haven't seen the movie yet, but it looks like from the previews that they have figured out how to shrink us to the size of an ant and so
make a little community that's smaller.
So they build a community the size of this studio, right? Imagine that if you're the size of an ant, how huge. This is 10 times bigger than
a big ass house.
They build out of Legos. Your $1 million $400,000 you have in your savings after you sold your house, all your vehicles, now is worth $10 million in the downsize me
role. Yeah.
And so people are like, fuck yeah, man. I've been hustling my whole life, 40 years old, grinding to make 80 grand a year and shit like that, barely getting by, middle class. And fuck, if I could turn this in, we have a mansion. So that's what people do. So it's pretty.
That sounds like a smart.
It's a clever
smart movie.
No, it's a clever. It's a clever movie.
Very clever.
Yeah, I thought it was clever.
I'd like to watch that. So here's another headline that came out. So this was, this actually was published in Science Daily last year, but I just became aware of it. This was a study that was done. It was a quite large study, and the source was, I'm reading here, Alina Health. Here's the title of the article in Science Daily. Most major heart attacks occur in people with normal cholesterol levels.
You put that in a forum.
I did.
I saw that.
So, which is, you know, we've known about this, dude. Here's the thing with cholesterol levels that is true. Cholesterol is, if you have high cholesterol, your all-cause mortality. So all-cause mortality takes all things into account. Cancer, Alzheimer's, heart disease, you know, diabetes, all the things that will kill you. If you have high cholesterol, your all-cause mortality rate is lower than someone who has low cholesterol. You might have a slightly higher correlation or connection to heart disease, but all-cause mortality goes down. Cancer in particular is inversely related. If your cholesterol is high, your cancer rate goes down. So does depression and anxiety. But what's funny about the studies, I'm reading it and they spin it in a way and say, oh, well, then we need to put people who have normal cholesterol on statin drugs, because statin drugs, I know you're shaking your head.
Hell?
I know. Yeah, they got to find
pharmaceutical companies.
You got to find something to do with all those pills they made. Yeah.
Think about it. If you're like a $10 billion industry and like they're like, oh, fuck, study came out that showed that normal cholesterol people get heart attacks.
Yeah.
Get the PR team together. Yeah. We got to figure out how we
make
can fucking
take some shit.
Spin this shit.
Isn't that really how they do that, though? Isn't that happen a lot where they have like a drug that ends, we find out that it has some adverse effect or that it's not as ideal for something? So they're like, fuck, find something else that we can use it for, and then they market. Hasn't that been done in history before? We've already had this happen.
That's what they always do, man.
Shit gets rebranded.
If you're a smart company, that's what you do. You know what I'm saying? If you're a smart business.
I wonder what the stat is on how many like drugs like that were intended to be for something else that they just found something else to
I can
use.
Name,
almost like side effects.
You know,
I can name two.
Yeah. Really?
I can name two off the top of my head.
Give me one.
Viagra. Viagra is number one.
What was that?
Viagra. So Viagra is a PDE5 inhibitor. It's a vasodilator. So PDE5 enzyme breaks down nitric oxide. When you inhibit that enzyme, you have more nitric oxide, so you get better blood flow. And the theory was better blood flow through vasodilation means lower blood pressure. So they had come out with they'd invented these drugs to lower blood pressure. And what they, this is literally what happened.
And everybody was banging.
They did studies and they're like, oh, it's kind of effective for lowering blood pressure.
Yeah, but you know what's doing really well?
Yes.
I'm banging the shit out of my wife lately.
He's rock hard.
But one of the number one side effects that these studies are listing is that people are getting erections like crazy. And so the brilliant PR marketing team or whatever from these companies was like, holy shit, we were going to try and crack into an industry that's going to maybe would have made us, you know, half a billion dollars. But now we can sell a boner pill, which is worth, half a trillion dollars. And that's exactly what they did.
That has to be one of the best success oops stories ever, right?
That's another minoxidil.
Oops, we just created a $1 billion market.
So minoxidil, same thing. Minoxidil was also supposed to, I believe initially was for, I think, blood pressure too. I'm not quite sure. But one of the side effects was when people got it on themselves, they grew hair. So they're like, oh fuck, let's sell this to men who want to grow more hair on their head.
Yeah.
And it became a product like that. So
kind of scary though, you know, it's kind of scary that that's just how, no, there's not probably a lot of thought that goes into it. Like, oh, this sucks, gross hair, let's sell it. But then no one really doing a lot of research on the potential side effects after using it for 10, 15, 20
exactly.
years.
Exactly. Yeah. I get dizzy from low blood pressure.
I wonder how many are out there. I wonder if there's a lot.
There's a lot. Yeah. So, and a lot of times like SSRI drugs or antidepressant drugs are more, I don't know if it's more often or almost as often as they're prescribed for depression. They're also prescribed for other things that have nothing to do with depression. So like if you want to quit smoking, right? You go to the doctor and you're like, I need to quit smoking. They will prescribe you on, they can prescribe
basically
you
something anything like, that makes you feel bad.
Yeah. Like Wellbutrin.
Like, oh, here.
Here's some Wellbutrin. Or I got back pain. They can't figure out why I have back pain. Try this antidepressant. Mm-hmm. And then sometimes it helps or, you know, whatever. That's the game, dude. The game is to, if you're a company that sells a product and you know what your market is, a time-tested strategy to make more money is to increase the size of the market now that you're advertising to. That's all it is. So if you look at, if you go back 30 years and you went to your doctor and they looked at your cholesterol, if it was above like 230, they would say that's high. Then they changed it and they changed it. Now it's, if it's over 200, that simple 30 number, between 230 and 200, that simple change opened up tens of millions of people now who now can prescribe statins. And that's what they're trying to do now with this and say, oh shit, people with normal cholesterol get heart attacks too. You know what that means? That means everybody should be on a statin because we have these studies that show when you put someone on a statin, it reduces this, that, and the other. But what it actually does is increase risk of muscle wasting, potential for cancer, and diet and depression and stuff like that. So,
Jesus,
I know, dude. Isn't that funny?
Hey, were you telling me that you and Jess were watching the new Planet Earth?
Yeah.
Oh.
Mind blowing.
That's been out for a long time.
So the new one?
It's not new. Yeah.
Well, it's been out not for that long, bro.
Yeah. On Netflix, it's new, but it's been out for a long time.
Well,
yeah, I thought this was new, and I got all excited, and I was like, I saw that like last year.
No,
dude.
There's two of them, right?
It's the second one.
Season
it's been
two.
Out for
so
a
it's
long
like a
time.
Year old.
Yeah, dude.
Okay.
Oh, I feel like it. Really?
Yes.
That's so weird.
You know, I know, because I got all excited. I was like, oh, dude, Sal said there's a new one out. And it's this. Yeah, it's been
well,
out.
Well, you're like that guy. You know that guy that everybody has a friend like this where you're like, dude, check out this new band. Like, I've been listening to them for fucking.
Yeah, he's
like forever ago. Yeah. Like, where have you been?
So is that what it is? Is like on Discovery Channel, if you watched it.
It was on Discovery first, and then the BBC produced it, and then now Netflix picked it up and put it on their
bro,
platform.
It's so brilliant. It is one of those things that, I mean, we were watching it just in awe.
I figured a hack out for myself. This is, so yesterday was just, for me, a stressful day. Just a lot I was trying to handle on one day, just as far as communication and the business and everything we had going on.
Oh, yeah.
And I just felt it. And I remember telling Katrina, I said, I was texting her on the way home. I'm like, I need one of those nights where we just reset.
So funny. I said the same thing.
Did you?
To Jessica. Yeah. Exactly the same thing.
So I said this.
We all must have been on the same page.
Right. So I got
home.
We're
all connected.
I got home.
Yeah. Connected.
Yeah. Right.
How does that work?
We all share a penis.
It's like a circle. Yeah.
So I get home and it's like, I don't know, 4 o'clock or so, which by the time I get home at 4 o'clock, I normally work for another like 4 hours on other stuff, social media, email shit, talking to fucking business stuff, whatever. Right. And so what I told myself was, okay, I need to fucking shut down. Even though there's a million things I need to get done right now, none of them will get accomplished by tonight, and it'll just stress me out more to continue this pace, and I won't sleep tonight. So I know that I got to begin this decompressing process right now, or I'm fucked.
Bro, that's smart.
Right?
Very
so
smart.
Then also I'm really good about letting my partner know heads up that I could be a pain in the ass tonight, because I've got all this. It's not you, it's me. I've got all this shit going on. I love you. Just heads up, right? So that was also the flowers was fucking thinking.
Oh, is that why you brought the flowers?
Yeah, yeah. So I'm thinking.
You were
I'm a forward thinker.
Oh, yeah. So preventative.
I'm probably going to say something stupid. Here's why.
Yeah, so, a little preemptive flower giving. God damn it. Let me write that down.
Right. Nice. So
strategy.
I'm texting back and forth with Katrina. She's probably got an hour before she's going to be home. And so I'm like, well, fuck, what am I doing? Well, her and I have our own shows that we watch, but we hadn't watched the season two. She doesn't get into it like I do. And so I'm
ever smoke a joint and watch it.
So I sat down.
It's life changing.
So I sat down, had a hybrid, got a little more, elevated than I normally would. Like, so typically I have my routine if I'm trying to relax or sleep, but it literally just takes me like two puffs and I'm good. And I'm like, I'm really fucking I'll have one of those days. So I had like half a joint, which is a ton for me. So I was pretty lifted, and so I decided, I'm like browsing on Netflix. I'm like, oh, I've been wanting to watch this, so I get into it. Dude, I got so sucked into that. Sucked into that. Katrina comes out, and she's like, let's, and she's like, let's go to the saw. She's trying to help me out. I'm like, I'm cool.
I'm good.
I'm so good right now. Like, don't bring anything else up about work, anything like this. Let's just stay focused.
How many episodes did you watch?
I think I burned through like three straight, dude.
Did you watch the one where, I don't know where it is, but it's like a mountain range, and in the daytime it's hot as hell, but then at night it gets
ice.
It gets cold so quickly that everything crystallizes.
No, so don't wait. Okay. What we can talk about, what I did see that I thought was fucking, I couldn't stop watching it.
Oh,
was
I know what you're going to say.
The crabs and the snakes.
Oh, it wasn't a crab. It was a lizard.
Oh yeah, lizard. Sorry,
yeah.
Lizard. There was a crab one also.
All the snakes coming out of all the rocks.
Yeah,
that looked like out of a movie, dude.
No,
it was really happened.
It was
somewhere.
An iguana, and it was running away. Yeah, from those snakes,
and it's going through the rocks.
Yes,
and out of
you thought it was dead, and it just kept like
out of
finding
every,
its way out of it.
Every corner of that, wherever it was, out of every hiding spot. Literally, like
snakes came from
50 everywhere. Snakes and from are, everywhere, and
like
fast
15 footers.
That iguana was a champion.
50, they were like 15 footers were chasing this little 2 foot or 1 foot iguana,
and they're just out of everywhere.
It looked like something out of a movie, right? It's like something that was fake. That like that doesn't happen.
You know what
snakes
it reminded me of? It reminded me of like you're watching a movie on mythology. Like the snakes are coming out, they're attacking.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
Didn't it look like that?
Insurmountable odds. It's just like fighting its way through
crazy.
All that shit.
Yeah. So. I haven't been this affected in literally.
You're going to share him right now?
I'm going to talk about it real quickly, but I haven't. Oh, there, he's got the video up there right now. What a great. Look at that. And they make it
so dramatic.
Yeah. It's so crazy. So I haven't been this affected and this impacted in, I don't know, a long, long time. I watched Jordan Peterson. Do a talk at the Emmanuel Theater in, I believe, the UK. And I shared that video with Adam, and I was very happy that you watched it right away.
Well, dude, psychology is my jam. So, like, that's what I love to listen to anyway. So when you sent it over to me and I started to watch the teaser, I was instantly sucked in. And then I started going down the rabbit hole of his stuff.
Dude, I highly recommend every one of our listeners, everybody, go on YouTube and look up Jordan Peterson. He does a talk at the Emmanuel Theater. He talks about his book, The 12 Steps to, I think it's 12 Steps to a Life Without Chaos or something like that. What a brilliant, brilliant man. The way he presents things, the way he talks about things, about our own human nature is just absolutely spectacular. And there's a couple things he said in there that were very basic, but and they're things that I know kind of, but just the way he puts them is just so brilliant. Like one thing that he said that I thought was just the way he said it was so good. Cause we talk about on the show all the time, how you should embrace, seek out moments and times where you think you're right and you may be proven wrong, and then embrace it because you now went from a state of unawareness to more awareness, or you went from not being right to now you're getting better information. You're growing. And what he says and the way, what he calls it is he says, make friends with what you don't know. Like make friends with that, because it's such a challenge to people when you're talking to someone, you want to be right. Everybody wants to be right versus wanting to grow and learn. Mm-hmm. And he said, what was that term he said about?
You're better being a transforming fool than a tyrannical king.
Than a tyrannical king. Like being right isn't important. What's important is that you grow and that you learn. And all the things that we tend to fight because we're proven wrong, we don't want to believe it, and there's all this, you know, cognitive dissonance and whatever. Like, embrace it and make friends with it. And then what'll happen is your growth will explode. It will absolutely explode. He talks about that and a lot of other things in that particular talk. So highly, highly, highly recommend you guys watch it.
I'm going to be late to the party on that one, but that sounds rad.
Dude, you got to check it out. And then you saw him eviscerate that journalist.
I did watch that, I watched that.
I posted that one on the forum,
too. That was great. That was great.
Yeah. Very, very cool.
I hope we get him on the show. That'd be awesome.
Oh, let me tell you, dude, that would be a dream, man. Like I said, it's been a long time since I found Milton Friedman. That was the last time I watched someone and was just so blown away by them. And Jordan Peterson's one of those. It's funny, too, because I posted a quote by him on my Instagram, and I've had a ton of DMs from people who listen to our show and listen to some of his lectures and stuff. It's pretty interesting. Another interesting thing about him is, so he's a clinical psychologist and a highly intelligent one, written lots of books. And Harvard professor. His daughter had lots of health issues and suffered from depression and rheumatoid arthritis. And I saw another video where him and his daughter were being interviewed, and his daughter talked about how she basically treated her depression that she's been taking medication. And remember, her dad is a psychologist. She's been treating her depression with SSRI drugs and anti-anxiety drugs for a long time, since she was 12. She was 24 in the video. And that what she did is she changed her diet, and how it, for the first time in her life since she was 12, it went away. It literally went away. And she has her dad on there who's, you talk to any psychiatrist or psychologist and you say, hey, you know, I'm thinking about curing my depression with food, and they'll roll their eyes or they'll get pissed off. I mean, very open-minded dad, right? And he talks about how, I saw this major change in my daughter and how I adopted some of the stuff that she said in her diet and how it, because he also has, it's mm-hmm. something that they runs in their family.
Very interesting angle, too, to kind of like attack, you know, mental problems with nutrition. Like, nobody talks about that.
You know, dude, here's what pisses me off. Of course, what you eat.
I know, it makes perfect sense.
Has an impact. What you eat has an impact. And we now know that depression and mental illness is strongly tied to and connected to inflammation. We know inflammation has a role that it plays in all of those things. Mm-hmm. And when you are in a state of inflammation because of autoimmune responses to food, then if you get rid of that, you're going to get rid of a lot of the things that may be causing your depression, and all of a sudden you'll feel absolutely fantastic. And the reason why I think a lot of psychologists and psychiatrists balk at that idea is because you'll read a million different stories and you'll have a million different ways people ate and it helped them. Like, this person over here went vegan and they cured their depression. This old person over here went paleo. And this person over here is eating the carnivore diet. And this person over here is going keto. And because Western medicine wants to standardize everything and have specific parameters, it sounds like bullshit. But when you keep in mind and understand that the human immune system is a fingerprint, like my immune system is mine. It is. There is no immune system that is identical to mine at all. That there are going to be foods that affect me in particular ways that are going to stimulate a immune response, potentially cause an inflammatory response that for you may be absolutely fine. You may eat an avocado, have no problem whatsoever, but I may have antibodies that have been built up from eating avocados. I'll eat that avocado. Now I get these issues. And so that's why it's so individual. Mm-hmm. So, great stuff. If I go down the rabbit hole on YouTube, so many lectures with that guy. Very, very cool stuff.
And
so.
you're already working on getting him, right? That's the whole idea right now.
I am working on getting him in here. Would love to have him in here. I think we would have a 4-hour podcast. Yeah. I really do. The guy goes off too. Like you ask him a question and you watch his interviews, he goes off.
Uh-huh.
And it's really, really cool. So cool. Did you guys try the dessert that I made yet?
I did.
Good. You made it?
We had it last night.
Really?
What did you think?
I apologize to all my Instagram people. I will do an Insta story. Fucking bomb. I put a little twist on ours, though. So
did you got the full-fat coconut milk in the can?
No, I didn't do that.
Okay,
sorry.
So what did you do?
What I did was I used the Cacao Bliss, right?
Organifi Cacao Bliss.
Yeah, so I had the Cacao Bliss. I put that in the Cocoa Whip.
Oh, that's right.
And we whipped that really hard, and then we put strawberries and then just a tiny bit of granola on it. Whoa.
Oh, that's right. Fuck, forgot it. About cocoa, yeah. The coconut whipped cream.
So that made it bomb.
Because we did, it tasted like
chocolate frozen yogurt with strawberries and a little bit of granola.
Dude, Organifi outdid themselves with that product.
Good. Two scoops of it. We used two scoops of it, and Katrina and I, it's serving for Katrina and I.
Because we did the same one last night where we got we got full fat coconut milk, and then we took I put it in the fridge that it separated, took the fat, the pure fat, and I blended that with the cacao bliss, and it's this super thick, creamy. It's like, I don't know how to explain it. It's almost like a frosting that you can put on a cake, and it's pure fat. So
you guys are so creative.
So if you're keto,
I'm so not.
Justin's like,
well, I put two scoops.
This is a big deal for me and a big game changer for me personally. And I'll tell you why, because I'm 100% know that I am addicted to sweets and sugar, and I've grew up my whole life. So for 25 years of my life, candy and ice cream and those things were a daily regular thing.
Yeah.
So I still battle and struggle with that. So finding these little alternative choices for myself that actually have a lot of health benefits behind it. So if I can actually have something that's somewhat healthy. Now, this isn't ideal. I shouldn't be eating this fucking for meals every single day. But when I have those moments when I'm late at night and I feel like I want that ice cream, it definitely satisfies that craving without all the extra side effects that come with slamming a Ben and Jerry's.
Sure. So some of the ingredients that are in there is there's of course raw cacao, which cacao is a I hate to use the term superfood, especially since we talked about cockroach milk, right? but it's a very 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 high in compounds that have been shown to be protective in the body, anti-cancer, anti-inflammatory. I've been on and off using raw cacao for quite a while. It also, if you take enough of it, will have a little bit of a stimulatory effect. So if you want something to kind of pick you up, but you're not trying to go with caffeine or coffee, you could do that. But then it also has, anti-inflammatory things in there. So there's turmeric in there. Then they have horsetail in there, which is a natural kind of diuretic, which is kind of cool if you're someone that holds a little bit of water. Now, here's what I find interesting about this. Typically, sweets make you hold water.
Right.
So they have something in there that does the opposite. Brilliant formulation. Yeah. But it does taste very, very good.
Well, and I used to use cacao in my coffee, and when we got it from Chimera, because Chimera has cacao also, but this cacao is like, it tastes really
good. It's like cacao.
No, it's got a really good flavor to it. It made that cocoa whip literally taste like chocolate frozen yogurt. I couldn't tell otherwise. Mm-hmm. It was pretty bomb. Mm-hmm. So
absolutely.
I'm stoked by it.
Bring it.
This quaz brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
First question is from Ginger Gamble. How do you guys go about your workout routines when fasting? Do you keep it as is? Do you light exercises or skip it completely for the period of the fast?
Depends.
That's probably the number one question I got from people while we were doing the fast.
Yeah, so if you're doing a fast, oh my God. Yeah, stepping away from the gym is like, yeah.
I'm glad you put it up there too, because that actually was probably one of the number one things I got inboxed also is, well, what are you doing for your workout? I've done both, right? So I've worked out fasted, and then I've had workouts where I don't. I think when you think of it this way, right? If you're somebody who, most of us are trying to reduce body fats one way or another, even if your goal is potentially to, build and be buff or whatever, for the most part, most of us have some extra body fat that we could lean out and use. So the way I look at it, it's not gonna hurt you to work out, but you don't need to. And you are already, because you're fasted, your body is already metabolizing fat all day. So if there was going to be a time that I was going to take off from the gym, I would more than likely do it when I'm running a 24 to 48 hour fast. But that's not to say that maybe I decided to do this fast right in the middle of me on my hardcore bulk and building for like a show or something like that, which I've done this before. and right and interrupted that process by doing a fast, I still lifted on that day because I was so on a goal to build, maintain as much muscle as possible. I'm also in my routine that I don't want to break, and I know that I'm not going to die or it's not going to hurt me to train while I'm also fasted. I probably just bring down the intensity level quite a bit because I don't need to.
Well, here's the thing too. If it's a prolonged fast, it might not be a good idea. Yeah. I know for me and for most people who do a 48-hour, some people get in 24 hours, but 48, 72-hour, when you start to go long, you get hypotension. This is where your blood pressure drops. It's a normal, natural. There's nothing wrong with it. But it can make you dizzy. Probably not a good idea to hammer yourself intensely in the gym. And the other thing, too, is you have to consider what you're doing the fast for. When I'm fasting, I'm not thinking to myself, I'm doing this to build muscle. I'm not doing this to yes, the side effect of the health benefits and the side effect of the fast, I may then, respond better to protein. I may then, be able to build more muscle as a side effect. But that's not really my goal. And I think the reason why we got this question so much from people is because people are so scared of losing muscle and performance.
Exactly. They want somebody to tell them it's okay to not work out that day. Right. That's what I think more than anything. And yes, it's okay not to work out that day. I used to work out and work out fasted, but it was typically when I was doing more of the warrior diet sort of protocol where I knew I was going to replenish my body afterwards. But for a prolonged fast, me personally, I don't really see a lot of benefit in trying to work out and be in that mindset in the gym where all the benefits of going through this prolonged fast, it's very much of a mental, a parasympathetic, like I'm trying to slow down. I'm trying to just work on, nice, lower intense type activities and just be mindful. And so it's a totally different feel.
Totally different. And I did a bunch of research before we did this because there was that one documentary I watched, which is Science of Fasting. I highly recommend it on Amazon.
I've been recommending that to everybody.
Yeah, really, really good documentary. It's great. And in there, they showed how in Russia or in Eastern European countries, how they've been using fasting medicinally for a long time. So people go to these clinics and they'll go there with something that is chronic, like asthma, rheumatoid arthritis, Crohn's, something that is chronic that we really don't have a cure for. All we can do is treat the symptoms. They'll go in there, and these are clinics that are run by medical professionals. So it's not like you're going to, I'm talking about Western medicine type professionals. So, it's not like you're going to, some hippie or whatever who's telling you to do this. You're going in there, it's a doctor. And what they do, and not saying that that's better, but what they do is they prescribe a fast to these patients. And many times the fast that they prescribe is over 2 weeks long. Many of them times 14 to 21 days. And what they do during that period of time is they monitor them for any potential adverse effects. And the vast majority of people have no issues whatsoever. But every once in a while, you'll see, this person is developing a nutrient deficiency, so we'll do this, that, and the other. But most of the time, there's nothing. And when I dug deeper off the documentary, when I started going online and digging deeper, they recommend that people exercise during the fast. Now, there's a big caveat here. It isn't your normal workout. You're not going to fucking work out. What they recommend is being active.
Right, moving.
Moving. Right. Tai Chi, yoga, maybe some stretching.
Walk on the beach. Yes. Nice little easy hike somewhere.
It's like blood circulation. Really.
I think a terrible combination with fasting is to fast and sit your ass down on the couch and don't move. I think that's a bad combination because that's extremely catabolic.
Yeah.
Now you're sending a couple signals to your body. One is we don't have food, which turns on a separate operating system and not necessarily bad, actually can be very good. But then you're sending another signal that says, not only am I not eating, but I'm not moving. And if you want your body to adapt in a way to reduce muscle, reduce all these other things that can potentially be negative to your health, well, now you're starting to do that. So if you're fasting prolonged, I highly recommend you stay active. And that's what I did. I did stretching. I did mobility work. Mm-hmm. I did not lift weights like I normally did at all.
Well, it was for hikes and walks and just spend some time in nature and you know, chilled.
Well, the bottom line is whether you do or you don't work out, it's really splitting hairs the difference of the impact it's going to make on you, right? Mm-hmm. It's not going to be super detrimental, and it's not going to be super beneficial to do either or.
Right.
So, and I think when you're doing this for health reasons, what I find for us, or what we did and Katrina did, you know, I try to focus on the other aspects of my health and fitness journey that I probably neglect. Like going to the gym and lifting the weights is something I'm very consistent about. Eating a certain way all the time, I'm very consistent with those things. What I'm inconsistent with is maybe the things like where I go take this quiet walk in nature, mm-hmm. or maybe I sit down and actually meditate for a half hour to an hour, or maybe reflect on some things, or maybe read, or these other aspects of my life that do affect my overall health, that this is a good time, I feel like, to focus on those things. Now, it's not to be said, like I said, if I was in the middle of a program or a certain goal that I'm getting and I want to be consistent and I want to go to the gym, well, then fucking go to the gym.
Well, and I think the paranoia being that, like, you're going to lose all this momentum when you get back to the gym, right? Like, you get fed, but the opposite is true. Like, for me, like, coming back in and then like refeeding and then going back to my normal schedule, I got so much energy, mental clarity, and like motivation. It's crazy.
So that's another thing people ask me is, am I going to lose muscle? Maybe. If it's long, probably. However, here's what you'll also experience.
So minimal.
First of all, it's minimal.
Right.
Second of all, it comes back very quickly and
very quickly
better.
Yeah.
So I obviously the day after my fast, you know, I'm back in the gym and I had, because then I had done my refeed or whatever, and which we should get into a little bit of how you do that properly. And then I went into the gym and worked out, and I went really easy in the gym because I hadn't eaten for 3 days and I just had one meal before that. And I was definitely not as strong, not as, you know, I didn't have all this crazy stamina, but the second and third workout was like boom, boom. All of us right now, I'm having better workouts than I've had in months, and it's because the fast.
The same thing.
Yeah, have you noticed the same
very
thing?
Very same thing. And it did. It was a little bit of a snail pace, you know, like the first, second day, and then it just like all of a sudden just took off.
Dude, I'm lifting heavier. I feel stronger. My mobility's better. So yes, initially you'll lose a little bit, just like if you go to the gym and hammer your legs, are you going to lose some strength from your legs the next day? Well, of course you are. You're sore, you're not going to be as strong. But then when your legs recover and adapt, you come back stronger. So you want to think of fasting that way. Now, I do want to touch on what you feed yourself to break your fast, because we talked a little bit about this, but I think universally the one thing I can recommend to people to have is bone broth. Bone broth is a very easy thing to digest. It provides the body with minerals. You've got some proteins from, you know, some gelatinous proteins which are high in amino acids that are good for the gut. It's high in sodium, which is something that you'll need more of. The one that I got was Thrive Market. Have you guys tried the Thrive Market bone broth?
I haven't tried theirs. No. And you've said something, you said you really like
so,
it.
So
whip some up.
So I've tried bone broth from Whole Foods. They sell it in the glass jar. I've tried several brands from Whole Foods, and they're all decent. They're all pretty good. Thrive Market by far my favorite one. It's the cheapest one too, which is of course crazy. But it comes in a carton, and that's what we did. We just, you know, opened up that carton. You pour it in a pan or whatever. You warm it up, a pot. You warm it up, and then just drink that, and wait about an hour, 2 hours before you start introducing food. Mm-hmm. Great way to break a fast. Also, of course, everybody knows bone broth is really, really good for gut health in general. Oh, there it is. Thanks, Doug. Grass-fed beef bone broth. $7 for a freaking carton of it, which for a 16.9 ounce carton, which is about half of what you would pay at a store like Whole Foods or whatever. So good stuff. Highly recommended.
Next question is from Joe Pushner. Curious if any of you have experience with orthorexic behaviors and the best ways to overcome it when you catch yourself in that mindset.
Ugh, for sure.
Ooh, like us personally?
For sure have I experienced orthorexic behaviors. I think...
Well, first explain to people what that is.
Yeah, so absolutely. Orthorexia is a term used to describe an eating disorder where you have to eat... Everything has to be healthy, perfect and healthy. Yeah. And anything outside of that causes great mental distress and is... basically, your quality of life has declined because you're so obsessed with everything having to be perfect and healthy with your food.
You're like neurotic about it.
Neurotic. Yeah. So it's not you just eat healthy. It's literally like if I go off of this.
It consumes like everything.
It consumes you. So it's an eating disorder. I have definitely experienced behaviors that I could clarify as orthorexic. I mean, for years, I ate, you know, 6 to 8 meals a day. And it was, you know, rice, beef, or chicken, broccoli, or asparagus, or tilapia. And it was the same thing all the time. I had to have a certain amount of protein. I had to have a certain amount of grams of carbohydrates, a certain amount of fat. I had to eat at a certain time. So my schedule, now remember this, you want to talk about, you know, orthorexic behaviors. Here I am, I own a, you know, small, you know, wellness facility, personal training wellness facility. I'm also personally training between 8 to 12 clients every single day. So I'm doing a shit ton of personal training. And I'm figuring out and organizing my schedule so that I can also eat, you know, one meal at home in the morning, but about 4 to 5 of my meals are at work. And I literally organized my schedule so that when one client left, I had 5 to 10 minutes, throw my food in the microwave, scarf it down, because I had to eat exactly. I would not go more than 3 hours without eating. So it was terrible. It was terrible for me because when that would get broken, if I went traveling with someone, if something happened, you know, I can countless times this would happen where I'd be with a client, we're finishing up our session. I know I'm going to have about 7 minutes to eat my meal. It's been exactly 3 hours. Client leaves, potential customer walks in. Now I'm talking to a potential customer about hiring me or one of my trainers as a personal trainer. That takes up my 10 minutes. Client walks in. I get this sense of, fuck, I'm going to miss my meal. And it would ruin my day. And it was, for me, it was such a breakthrough moment to realize that wasn't important. If I skipped meals, it didn't affect my muscle mass and my performance. And then from there, once I was able to break free from that behavior, I was able to examine it and say to myself, well, that was fucking dysfunctional. I can't believe how attached I was to that. Because when you're in the middle of it, you don't see it. You know what I mean? You don't see it. You just think it's totally normal. So that's one I can say for myself.
You know, I think that it makes the most sense that being the guy who competed and carried and lugged his food around and weighed and measured everything, that I would have for sure dealt with this or battled with this at one point. But if I'm being completely honest, I don't think so. And I think an example of that, and I'm sure I'm surprising somebody who would assume that because I was in the competitive world and you do those things, that I would struggle with, you know, weaving in or out of that. But you know, I was somebody for almost 4 years, so probably about 3.5 years consistently, was more anal, more dialed, more consistent with exactly a lot of things that Sal was saying. But at the same time, too, I had no problem letting it go. In fact, I actually looked forward to the day that I could let it go. I did it. And a lot of the things that you said, Sal, that I also did, I did it because I was under the impression that's what the science said. I thought I was reading the right information, that, you know, trying to get a meal after 20 minutes after working out. Now, I didn't fret about it because I didn't hit it all the time. I missed it a lot.
Now, what about when you were younger and, you know, because I know we've talked about this, and you're like afraid of losing weight and you have to eat, you know, a certain amount, and if you don't, you're going to lose muscle.
Okay.
That's not orthorexic, but that's...
So there probably was a time in my life, in my teenage years to early 20s, where you know, trying to stuff myself to gain weight, but again, even then, there wasn't so much of a fear about it, or as much as I thought that this is what I was supposed to do to gain weight. And when I found out that wasn't true, when I read the literature, when I really understood and I really learned, it was actually a great relief to not feel like I need to do that. So I feel like if you have these orthorexic behaviors, you get more, I don't know, I didn't have this fear. I didn't have this fear of doing this or not doing that. Like, I see it in clients for sure. I've trained people that struggle with letting go. Oh, if I start eating that way, I'm going to get super fat, or I'm going to be this way. Or, oh, if I, you know, if I don't do this, then I'm going to look this way. Like, I didn't ever have that fear. I just thought, like, hey, I want to get bigger and I'm having a hard time. I need to eat more food. I got to keep eating more food. I'm not eating enough food. And there was actually some truth to that. You know, I was just burning and moving so much I couldn't consume enough to do it. I just had a bad approach at it because I didn't really understand how to do that. I didn't understand nutrition at the level that I do now. So I really didn't. I didn't have a lot of those behaviors. And you would think, again, now I am very familiar with it. And maybe that's why, too, because when I got into competing, that I was...
How old were you when you started competing?
30.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I'm older than that. Yeah, because I'm 36 now. I was only 40, so 32.
Even. Yeah, because when... I dealt with all my shit in my early
20s. And let me tell you, because you and I are a lot alike in a lot of ways, but you are, you know... You are more hypomanic about certain things when it comes to your fitness goals.
Oh, for sure.
And I know that's your science background and your thinking. And I know
that's my personality with anything.
Yeah, right.
Anything I get into, I can get
and I'm not that way. I can let go of things. I can weave in and out. I'm not attached to it very much. I can be so crazy where I'm carrying my food everywhere I go and measuring everything that I eat and counting every calorie for 3 years every single day, and then all of a sudden turn it off the next day. And not have it again and actually be completely fine. So, but I think that what I did learn from being around so much of it inside of the competitive world was because I had the education, because I had trained so many people before that and dealt with this so much, when I got into it, I was blown away and fascinated by how predominant it was in that community, because I had the impression going in that these would be the elite of elite minds when it comes to nutrition and working out, and I was going to learn something. I went into it thinking, like, these guys and girls are going to fucking teach me a lot. I can't wait. Like, I think I'm a smart guy. I know what I'm talking about getting into this. Then I got into it and realized, oh, fuck, these people have fucking worse eating habits and patterns and relationships with food and exercise than the motherfuckers I've been helping for my last 15 years. Like, this is crazy. So maybe that also helped me not get sucked into potentially reverting back to those behaviors. But yeah, I didn't really struggle with that. I mean, I think if you're a mind pump listener, hopefully if you struggle with that, we've helped you work through that. Cause I feel like a lot of what we discuss a lot about the relationship with food. I mean, that's what the intuitive guide was written for, was to help people, whether it be orthorexia or anorexia or any sort of eating disorder. You know, we've addressed and talked about it quite a bit.
The question also is, how do you, you know, what are some best ways to overcome when you catch yourself in that mindset? The most effective thing I found, there's a few strategies that I've used with clients who have dealt with, who have orthorexic type behaviors. And one that seems to be the most effective is the following. People who, there's a few root causes to orthorexia, or like any food issue. A lot of it has to do with control. It's a feeling of control. So it's anorexic, bulimia, orthorexia, you know, bigorexia, what they'll call guys who want to eat a lot of food because they feel skinny all the time. That all centers around control. But with orthorexic, there's this underlying, I want to be healthy. Like, this is for my health. So they justify it by saying, but I'm eating healthy food. Mm-hmm. And so what I do with...
Which rings competitors, right?
Right.
I mean, that's what...
Right. And so what I say to these people who are really, really... who have now told themselves, although they don't really believe it, because if they really were about their health, they would understand that what they were doing was wrong, but they really want to believe that it's about the health, is I explain to them that food is a lot more than how it feeds your physical body. So I'll explain to them, and I'll say,
or how it affects you aesthetically.
All of that. So if you're eating food, you can break food down into its components, proteins, fats, carbohydrates, micronutrients, phytonutrients, all these other things, how it affects your body. Is it healthy for you? Is it going to help you maintain leanness? Is it going to help performance? All those things. That's important. But that's not all food is. If it was, we would not have the elaborate cultures that we've designed and created around mealtimes and eating, and there wouldn't be cultures where they make food particular ways, and there wouldn't be this long... I mean, food is way more than the sum of its parts. Food means a lot more to us than just sustenance. If it was just sustenance, let me tell you something right now, there would be no problem with illness, obesity, there would be no problem with anything else. Food is a lot of different things, and food can feed a lot of things, not just your physical body. And the examples I like to give are, you know, you're, let's say you haven't visited your parents in a long time, and you go visit your mom, you haven't seen her in a few months, and she makes that homemade pie that she made when you were a kid, and she gets a glass of wine out and says, hey, let's sit down and have some good conversation and, you know, eat this pie that I used to feed you when you were a kid and drink this alcohol, and we'll get a little loose and we'll have a great time. At that moment, you're not feeding your physical body. That wine isn't doing you any benefit, neither is the pie. It's, you know, it's full of sugar or whatever she decided to make it with. But what you're feeding is maybe that connection you're making with that person in front of you. Or maybe you're feeding a feeling. You know, there's a lot that goes. And when you acknowledge that and you can acknowledge it and connect to that and become aware of that, now you're a step closer to eating intuitively. Now if I go on a vacation and I'm sitting at a coffee shop in France or I'm sitting at a restaurant in Italy and I'm watching people walk by and they serve me this pasta dish with fish that's just fresh from the ocean right over here, and I'm eating, I am not thinking about carbs, proteins, fats, and how it's going to make my body look. I am savoring the flavors and the environment that I'm in, and I'm creating emotions with that food. I'm creating an experience, and at that moment, that's what I'm feeding. And when you understand that, it'll help you, because it will also help you from harming yourself with food. Because I had a message from one of my clients yesterday, and he goes, you know, Sal, I'm really sorry. My friends came to visit. I hadn't seen them in a couple months. And we were all reminiscing, and we went to the pizza parlor, this one that we used to go to when we were younger, and we ate pizza and we drank some beer. I'm really sorry, man. I'm going to make up for it today. And I'm like, no, man. There's a big difference between ordering pizza, eating it at home, and trying to drown your sorrows versus you went out and met with your friends you haven't seen for a long time. I said, at that time, you weren't feeding your goals, which was fat loss or whatever, but you're feeding something else, which is also important. And so when you understand that, I think, and so far I've had, with my experience, I've had success with clients with orthorexic behaviors because they tell themselves so much that it's about their health, that when they realize that their health is much bigger than just the physical, then they're able to step outside of it a little bit and start testing it, and then you can kind of break through a little bit.
I have something to add. I'm just kidding. I don't. You guys have fun with that.
Next question is from Grant Killian 5. Please talk about appetite pills. As a trainer, it's so frustrating to talk to people who want to take a pill to stop cravings. What are the most important habits to cut off cravings?
You know what an appetite suppressant pill reminds me of?
What?
It's like taking a pill for a headache. So if you have, that's assuming that they work. So we'll get there in a second. But let's say.
Don't ruin that for me. I feel like sometimes when I get a headache, fucking Advil works just
well,
fine.
Well, so check this out. I'm going to simplify it, right? Let's say you're literally banging your head against the wall. So you stand in your room.
Because I do this a lot.
And you smash your head against the wall over and over again. And you're getting a headache. And so I'm like, oh, fuck, I'm just going to keep taking these headache pills to numb the pain from a headache. Instead of saying, oh shit, I'm an idiot, let me just stop hitting my head against the wall. If you have these really strong quote unquote cravings, taking an appetite pill, and I'm pretending that they work because many of them, they actually don't, but let's just say they do. Taking a pill that suppresses your appetite is not solving the problem at all. It's
masking it.
It's handling, you're handling a symptom, but that symptom will erupt in another way. If you take away, and there's plenty of evidence for this, by the way, I'm not just making shit up. All you have to do is look at gastric bypass patients. You look at people who are morbidly obese, who obviously have an issue with food, who are, you know, 300, 400, 500 pounds, who have a surgery to remove most of their stomach. So now all they have left is a pouch the size of your thumb.
But they're going to maximize every square inch of that new tiny little stomach.
They're going to do that. And if food was... if that's a symptom of something, if the reason they were eating so much wasn't because they were hungry, it was because of something else, and now they've eliminated that ability because now they can't eat a lot, you have a dramatic increase in alcoholism, you have a dramatic increase in drug abuse and depression. So that's the thing with appetite pills. Now, do they work? Maybe a little bit. There are some compounds that have appetite suppressing effects, but your body adapts really quickly. And then they stop losing that effect. And then when you go off the pills, good luck. Have a great time, you know, eating like crazy.
It's called willpower.
And feeling like shit.
Like discipline.
Yeah, and feeling like shit. So, Adam, I know you because you dieted for so long with shows, which is insane. Those are cravings on another level.
Yeah.
What are some strategies you use to...
Well, higher fats. So I noticed a significant difference when I lowered my carbohydrate intake. So high carbohydrate diets, this is the downfall of it. Like, so I'm not demonizing carbs because I think that I still introduce carbs into my diet. And I think you can totally have a diet that has carbohydrates in it. But if you struggle with cravings, a diet that's higher fat and lower carbohydrate tends to really, I mean, this almost always solves this problem. So when I've had clients in the past that come to me and they're like, oh my God, Adam, I crave this and I crave that, I look at their macro profile, and what I typically end up doing, and they're almost always, they're people that are eating 150, 200, 300, 400 plus grams of carbohydrates and, you know, moderate to low fat type of diet. And I take them and I flip the macro profile on its head, and it almost always solves it. Now, you have some people that are like myself, who are dealing with an addiction to something like sugar because they've been doing it for 30 something years. Now you have a new monster, you know, because that's, and I'll tell you what helps me are higher fat diets. So what I loved about us going through this fasting process, I just came off the holidays. I'm very transparent about what I've been doing during that process. I've been fucked up. I'm going through all kinds of shit. So I'll tell you right now, my diet has been all over the place. I've been enjoying the holidays. I've been enjoying sweets in moderation. I'm not getting out of control or getting fat by any means, but I'm definitely not dialed in, and I'm definitely eating a lot of carbohydrates and sugar. And all what has come with that are all the other bad habits, which is I'm craving the Diet Cokes like crazy. I'm craving sweets like crazy. I'm craving all these things. Because I've now reintroduced them into, allowed them. And at the beginning, it's not so bad. But then after week two, week three, week four of consistently allowing a lot of these foods, it triggers that response for me. And now my body is like, oh, I really want one. So the fast was incredible. The fast kind of reset that for me. And then why before we went into fast, you guys kind of did it for your own reasons, but it was a perfect timing for me because I was already struggling with this internally, and it was something that I wanted to address and handle. And so going into the fast, I didn't care if I went 24, 48, or 72. For me, it was about resetting the bad patterns and stuff that I had created for myself previously, and then kickstarting the macro profile that I wanted to follow now. And I had carbs the other day. I had some rice the other day. I had what did I have the other day? So I've been getting more carbohydrates in the diet, but I'm very careful about which ones I'm allowing in the diet because I know that once I start kicking that carbohydrate intake up, that it can really easily lead to these other cravings that I have. So that's worked really well for me. That's worked incredibly well for clients. So utilizing tools like fasting, utilizing tools like high fat diets. And then when you do have, I have patterns and habits. So for 20 years, I had, this is no exaggeration, I've shared this on a show before, a Ben and Jerry's fucking ice cream every single night. Like for 20 years.
A quart, right?
Yeah. Like literally, consistently. That was a staple.
Justin's like, he did.
That was a staple.
It was there.
Staple food that I allowed in my diet, and I justified it because I was in shape. I was in shape. You know, I was always 10% body fat or so and lifting weights. But what that has done, it has not only created cravings that I have intrinsically from that, but also has created behavioral patterns for myself that naturally when I sit down to watch a movie or TV at night with Katrina, I want ice cream.
You create an association.
Totally.
All on your own.
100%. And I'm very aware of it, you know? And so like we talked about this Cacao Bliss, I love hacks like that. I've got a ton of them too. So, and I know one day we'll probably try and put them all together and put them in a book for you guys and monetize that shit. But right now I'll just keep sharing it when I can and sharing it on my Insta story and sharing it with you guys on here. But I've got a ton of these little, you know, yogurt and cacao and cocoa whip and rice cakes with these things and strawberries and fruit, things that I've done that give me that kind of sensation of, you know, feeding that habit, but at the same time too, getting something that's nutritionally beneficial for my body. So that's been a game changer for me.
What do you crave when you crave something? Are you more sweets or
pizza?
Salty? God, that's the ultimate, right?
Oh yeah. No, it's anything. Yeah, more salty fat. You know, I really don't have sweet cravings as much. Like Adam, though, like I grew up with a lot of shit food like that, like ice cream for dessert, like almost on the regular, you know, sugary cereal in the morning. So it like sparks this whole process of like, you feel like shit during the day and you don't know why. And, you know, like looking back, it's so crazy. Like how much like I could have done better and like would have had like great energy and mental clarity if I just would have like handled my diet better and wouldn't have all these like internal problems I'm still dealing with now because of what I did back then. But yeah, for me, it's like I literally I'll crave cheese or like meat. Like those are my two like main cravings. So
I you know, it's funny. I remember distinctly several times where I think like there was something going to happen at school. Like, oh, I got to take this test and you know, we were always told have a big meal for breakfast. It'll prepare you for your day or whatever.
Like pancakes, you know?
Yeah, like dude, I would have like waffles with syrup. Yes. Bowls. And then I feel like shit.
Oh my God.
Or before, you know, before
crash.
An athletic, you know, endeavor or before I'm going to go do a run or before a tournament. I remember before a judo tournament, I was, yep. I want to say 14 maybe. I was 14 years old. I was going to do a judo tournament and I remember like, oh fuck, I want to be fueled. I want to have all this energy. And I ate a whole bunch of just carbs, a bunch mm-hmm, of processed, mm-hmm. And I felt terrible. I felt so bad, and I didn't put it together until much later.
And then you try and make up for it with like a ton of caffeine.
Yeah, know? Exactly.
Like, and you're just like, oh, this is going to be the formula.
Exactly. And, no, and here's the thing with appetite pills. The ones that actually do work stimulate a sympathetic response in the body. So they get the body to release these catecholamines, epinephrine, norepinephrine, which will suppress your appetite. However, it's very short-lived. If you do it consistently, after about between a few days to a week or so, your body starts to adapt. Either your receptors that these these chemicals attach to start to downregulate, your body starts to produce less of these chemicals, or both, and then you start to find that they stop working. But then you're left in a shitty situation when you go off the pills, because then you stop taking the appetite pills. Now your body's producing less of these catecholamines and you've got your receptors downregulated, and then you go through that withdrawal period. And typically when people stop appetite suppressant pills, they binge when they go off of them. And so at the end result is worse than if you never took them in the first place.
Next up is Linz Bauer. If you had to hire another Mind Pump host, who would it be and why?
Oh shit.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to start with why I would not, first of all. Right. Cause
well, yeah,
I would never even think about, and people that have been maybe in this situation appreciate this. Those that have no idea probably fucking don't understand. That's why they keep recommending, oh, why don't you guys get a girl or why don't you do this? I would never change the dynamic of this show. I think it would be the biggest mistake we ever made. I remember when we first started, and I'm not going to lie, there was a part of me that was curious to see, because we did do this. We did do an episode with just me and Justin, just me and Sal, just Sal and Justin. Mm-hmm. And quite frankly, they all sucked.
Yeah.
And it's not because...
mine with Justin's was good. It was like,
we did have high ratings.
Yeah, it was really high. But...
So there really is something magical about the dynamic and what exactly everybody contributes to the conversation.
Definitely.
And I know I'm smart enough to know that I would never change that. All we try to do is continue to improve upon it and sharpen each of our individual skills, but changing that dynamic, I would do. Now that being said, I would add Kevin Hart.
Kevin Hart.
So if we were.
Oh, you're aiming
low. That's funny. You said a comedian. I'll get to mine.
Yeah. So I would add Kevin Hart because just for the entertainment factor. That's why. Because I think if I were to give any more to the show, I don't want it to be any more sciencey. Like I'm not looking for. I don't need a bigger nerd than Sal.
No, we got that's that fucking, covered.
Yeah, he's got that covered. Yeah. Like that's cool.
Yeah.
If anything, a more entertaining piece to what we already bring to the table. So Kevin Hart's mine. That's where I'm going.
That's solid.
What about you, Jake?
Yeah, mine a very similar train of thought, but mine was Bill Burr.
Just okay. Damn, I love him.
We can agree on that.
Well, yeah, just because I love the way he thinks about things. It's not just like
that may be better than Kevin Hart.
His comedy is amazing. Like, but just like
it's our flavor.
He'll listen to like somebody's train of thought, you know, or like whatever the issue is out there, and then he'll think about it. And he'll come back and he just highlights like so many holes in the way that people think about things, and he's brilliant. And I just think that he would be able to kind of give us a whole new angle that would make it like, oh shit, and it'd be hilarious.
Bro, how much does Bill Burr remind you of Joe DeCina?
Yeah.
It's like his twin.
I told you guys that I sent it over to him, really? Right?
He knew who Bill Burr
no.
was.
No.
He didn't?
No, he never
That's
heard
his
of,
twin.
Never heard of him before. I said, you got to listen to him because he reminds me of you.
If you haven't.
His delivery oh, is.
Storytelling. If you haven't listened to the episode where we interview Joe DeCina, who's the founder of Spartan Race, you have to listen to it. one of the best storytellers.
Well,
I've ever.
I posted on Facebook, the forum, right, this yesterday, because we're trying to redo our media kit. And our media kit is something that we spend to potential sponsorships or other companies that want to do something with us. And it just kind of gives us breakdown our stats, this and that. And one of the ways I want to bolster the media kit is having like our three, you know, best episodes and three on the podcast and three YouTube. And so who better else than to ask like our private forum, who I think gives it to us straight all the time. So that's why I posted that for those of you that are wondering. And the Joe DeCino was actually mentioned multiple times. So
yeah. You said Bill Burr, I was like, oh yeah, he just reminds me.
Yeah, no, that's it. You know what? That fuck, I'll give you.
Solid.
That trumps my Kevin, because I like Kevin Hart a lot and I think it'd be funny, but I think Bill Burr would be even better.
I'm thinking conversationally. Right. It would go in like so many weird directions. I would love it.
Yeah. He would mesh better with.
So
all
you
of
guys
us.
Are going big celebrity. Yeah, I did not think like
he
that.
Was like some.
You're thinking
guy.
Of people we've like had
another podcaster.
I'm thinking
fuck that, bro.
No, thinking, I was like, you're not getting
that. There ain't nobody we hung out with that I'd rather have than one of you
here. Well, assholes. No, I'm thinking like
fuck that.
I just wasn't there. Like I wasn't thinking because if I'm going,
let
celebrity,
me hear it. Tell us. You got to tell the truth.
If I'm going celebrity,
no.
Hold on. If I'm
give us what you're.
I'll do both. I'll do both.
All right.
If I'm going celebrity, I would say someone like Oprah, who
what?
Yes.
You're bad at this
game. No, dude.
You're bad at this game.
Watch her conversations
with
people.
I'm not saying Oprah's a G, dude. Oh,
we all love her, but would that be a good, like, constant conversation?
I think having her in here with us would be hilarious. But I was thinking, I wasn't going super celebrity. I was thinking like people we know.
No, you know what you're
podcasting.
Trying to? You're trying to win over the audience, bro.
Not at all.
You know, it's fucking. No. It's a good shot.
Bro,
everybody
let me
likes
tell you something right now. If you've been listening to the show long enough, you know I don't try to win anybody over. So you either love me or you hate me.
That's very
so
true.
So I would say the guy that I had in my mind is another podcaster. He's a friend of ours. I was going to say Mike Matthews. I think he's a very intelligent guy. That.
Yeah, you guys hit it off. Like,
I think
you're besties.
Very smart dude. Great conversation.
100%. The only problem with that is he's you.
Yeah, I know.
It wouldn't be that different.
Yeah.
I don't need two of you.
You sell light.
Yeah, yeah. I
thank you, Justin. I was like, dang, my heart hurt a little bit. Adam said,
here's the deal.
It's not even close, bro.
If you die, that's who we're going to replace you with.
Yeah, so okay.
So
that's a good game.
That's a different game.
That's
right?
A good game.
That's a different game. If each of us died, who are you putting in your place? I would have to say Matthews is probably one of the people that would actually fill your spot the best.
It'd be tough, though. It's a tough thing.
Yeah. I don't think anyone fills our shoes, right? Nobody fills each other's shoes.
All right, well, who are you guys then?
Oh, my God.
I don't know. You guys would have to do that.
Are we playing the death game?
Yeah, exactly.
I was thinking, I don't know, I think Brendan Schaub for Adam a little bit.
I like that. That's
just because his storytelling and his ridiculous ideas, like, they're great.
If Brendan Schaub.
He fucks up words all the time, too, by the way.
Does Brendan fuck up words?
All the time.
I like him
so
more.
So if Brendan Schaub and Bradley Martin had a kid, kid grew up, that would be. That'd be who we replace you with.
I do like the
shop. We do need some handsome.
And shout out to my boy Bradley, though. I got much love for him. I was just talking to him the other day, and we're heading down there to Zoo Culture in 3 weeks, so that's not a bad compliment either. Although I think I when I listen to Brendan Schaub and just where he's at mentally and where he's at in his life, I connect probably more with him. Although I do,
he says what's on his mind. He doesn't give a fuck. You know.
Bradley, you know what Bradley reminds me of is the younger version of myself. I mean, I got eight, 9 years on him. So he's, you know,
I forget how young he is.
Yeah, he's young, dude.
I forget about that.
Yeah, so he definitely reminds me. I mean, spot on. Like when we talked off air, I was like, "Fuck, this guy is fucking me." 8 years ago,
yeah, same thing. Justin would be tough, huh?
Yeah, I don't know.
Who'd be a Justin?
Good luck.
Exactly.
Yeah, come up with something.
Well, yeah, trying to think.
We just figured out who's irreplaceable. It's Justin.
It's probably true.
The fan favorite.
The favorite.
You know how irritating that is? Yeah. You know?
I was talking shit to them.
I talk at least 10 times more than you do, but you're the fucking fan favorite. You know? Fuck you guys.
Yeah. Maybe that's the secret.
That is a secret. Right. No.
That's George Costanza.
That's real love.
We were when we were at the LA Fit Expo, every like fifth person would come up and be like, "So where's Justin? He's my favorite."
Yeah.
Be like, damn.
God, I love you.
Yeah.
See? Pump heads get me.
We were crying. Yeah. So if you go to YouTube, you can find our 30-day workout. It's free. It's all programmed out. So what we did is we give you a workout every single day. Includes mobility, strength training. We progress you through, too. So it's not just like random workouts put together. They all connect. Start on day one. Progress yourself all the way till the end. It's absolutely for free. You can find it on our YouTube channel, Mind Pump TV. Subscribe.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic, 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.